Thank you for listening to this forum podcast. Please check out our website for a rich archive of podcasts and writing from contemporary philosophers and other researchers on a wide variety of topics. The Forum is an educational charity dedicated to bringing academic philosophy to a broader audience. Please consider donating to us via our Just Giving page, which you can find on our website. Happy listening.
Hello, so I'm Shahida Bari. I'm one of the fellows of the Forum and I'm chairing this event. Thank you for abandoning spouses, boyfriends, partners this evening, spending the evening with us instead, and hopefully you'll fall wildly in love with our speakers instead. This event is part of a stream of philosophy and arts panel discussions that have been hosted by the Forum. We had an event on jazz last semester, some of you might have come along, and in May we're going to have an event on philosophy and film with Francine Stock from BBC's film programme and Lenny Abramson, the director of Room, so that'll be really exciting. But this session is The House That Philosophy Built. The panel considers how philosophers have engaged with architecture and explores how architects have thought philosophically about their own work. Are there philosophical ideals at the heart of civic building projects? How does a three-dimensional space represent an idea? Is the primary purpose of building aesthetic, social, or moral? And how should we imagine the skyline of the future? Our three speakers are: Peg Rawes is a professor of architecture and philosophy at the Bartlett School of Architecture at UCL. Her research focuses on social, architectural, and material ecologies. And you can see her work in a short film called Equal by Design, which we'll get a hint of during our presentation. And the film thinks about well-being, equality, and the housing crisis in the UK. Her books include Poetic Biopolitics, Practices of Relation in Architecture and the Arts. Kristen Kreider is a poet, an artist researcher, and one half of the collaborators Kreider O'Leary. She works with sites of architectural and cultural interest. Her books include Poetics and Place, The Architecture of Signs, Subjects and Site. She's Professor of Fine Art at Goldsmiths College. And Juliet Haysom is an artist with particular interests in architecture and place. She was the winner of the Gerwood Sculpture Prize in 2007 for Spring, which was an installation in the park around Radley Hall in Warwickshire. And she's currently working on two commissions in Bristol, and she teaches at the University of the Arts and the Architectural Association. The format is that each of our speakers will have 10 minutes to speak on their angle. We'll park after each speaker and I'll ask a question. I'll encourage you to ask each other questions. And then after the three speakers, we'll open up to the floor as soon as we can. Okay? Great. So I think, Peg, you're starting us off.
Yeah. Great. Thank you. Okay, well, very nice to see you all. Thank you very much for the invitation from Shahida and from Beth. I'm going to talk about three areas of concern around architecture and philosophy that I think are really key at the moment. So I'm not going to be doing a history of ideas and going right back to ideas of classical philosophy. I think there'll be other chance for conversation afterwards. But I really wanted to sort of bring up the conversation around discussions in architecture and in design, which are really substantial and really important in terms of how we think about design contributing to society. So I'm going to have three areas. The first is housing and well-being, and then I'm going to talk about computation and technology, and then I'm going to end talking about ecology. So maybe, Shahida, if I get to 7 minutes, and could you do me a wave and tell me where I am? Okay, so just to begin, a few introductory comments, which if those of you are in architecture, you'll be aware. If you're in student or in academia, you'll be aware of. If you're not, you may not necessarily know these elements. So I'm going to just say a little bit about where architecture and philosophy share concerns. And the first is that really I think both of them are about building. They both build worlds or realities, individuals, places, environments, polis, society and also politics. Now, architecture is explicitly about the built environment, about buildings, but it also contributes in building other kinds of environments, other kinds of phenomena. So I want to just really highlight that when I'm talking about architecture, I'm talking about both buildings, but also architecture is a discipline that has other kind of modes and practices, other kinds of ways of thinking about what it contributes to society, and these are sort of in a way about languages. And just for those of you who are not familiar with architecture and the way it's taught, the way in which practitioners may think of their own work and their contribution to the discipline, it's a discipline which has a kind of parallel, if you like, world alongside the built environment, which is often called paper architecture. And this is a very important mode of thinking, mode of experimenting, and a mode of practicing poetics, politics, social work, social ideas and material forms. And it's really, if you like, the kind of language that architects will learn to develop when they are studying. It also is used in competitions. Practices and studios use it to develop ideas. So these are not ideas that go to a client. A client doesn't request them as part of a building, but they're very much part of the discipline. So I just want to highlight that because I think this is quite a key part of what might come out in what I say now. So just to move to the first section, I want to talk really first about housing and wellbeing. Those of you who are interested in philosophy will obviously perhaps know about very key texts like Heidegger's Thinking Day. Thinking, his very key text on dwelling. But I want to really highlight a discussion that goes back to the 17th century, and this is the thinking of Baruch Spinoza, the philosopher based in The Hague and in Amsterdam and in Leiden, and working in the 17th century at a time when we could call it the Radical Enlightenment. Now, he's working in a context where at that time social welfare and the idea of the city, the idea of urbanisation, is really, really at a very, very high level of development. It's very like our current day. There's a huge sense, potentially, of a sort of neoliberal or a capitalist environment. And Spinoza is someone who is working through a philosophical method. And his method, interestingly, is not of his time. It actually goes back to Euclid. He uses what's called the geometric method. And this is a method that he really basically repurposes from mathematics, and he applies to thinking about the idea of the self, the subject, who we are, and how we come to live as individuals and also as society. And his way of doing this is that he thinks about the idea of the self through this text called The Ethics. And this is a text which, if you go to look at it, is not terribly accessible. It's not very user-friendly, but it's a fascinating text because it's where he brings mathematics and scientific thinking together with a study of the subject. And he takes the most irrational of our senses of self, which is the emotions, the passions, and he calls these the affects. And what he does is he looks really at how to be happy. And people have talked about this, like Damasio of a Book of Joy. The way in which I think it's interesting is it looks really particularly at the idea of ratio. Now, ratio is a term that is the basis of reason, the notion of reason or rational thinking. It's a question at the moment which is really in, I think, key critical crisis if we think of what's happening in the global sphere and the lack of reason and the denigration of it. So he's someone who really is looking at this, but he's not applying it to the notion of a sort of elevated society. He's looking at it in terms of the common everyday person, the human. And this in a way is what we could call a kind of care of self. Care of the self. It's possibly therefore linked to psychoanalysis or therapy, but we could also think about it in terms of our social or our political or our senses of agency in the world. Now, what I've done with this is to look at the idea of Spinoza located in text but also in place, and this is the plaque from the Spinoza House in The Hague. And I've worked with a philosopher called Beth Lord, and we produced this film, which was in collaboration with the production company Lone Star, and then we talked really particularly about social housing and the idea of these values, these ideas of ratios between well-being, happiness, agency, and where you live and how you live as being an incredibly strong aspect of thinking about housing, which again today are huge discussions. Issues of quality, ratios of quality, but actually ratios of inequality. to a lot of our work, which I won't go on to say too much more about now, but I'm very happy to expand on, in this was looking really at ratios of inequality and how Spinoza was actually someone very, very aware of this, but also someone who was very interested in the idea of difference. So rather than thinking about the idea, and he actually does talk about a house, how a designer might build a house through the capacity, the power of their emotions, rather than the idea of design as a blueprint, which is about mimesis or copying. Oh, sorry, I keep pushing the wrong button. Okay, the next slide I want to go to is really to turn to talking about computation. Now, in the middle of this slide, I know it's an intentionally historic slide. It's a slide of Beirut. And in the middle of it is a building that's been constructed, which is a Zaha Hadid architecture practice. And it's an example of a building facade that has been designed through computational software. So what I want to now really highlight, and this is where my conversation comes a bit more again up to the present day, and the concerns that are in architecture, which are about economics, about how you build, what you design with, what kinds of frameworks, what kinds of architectures you use, and the computational, technological input into architecture is incredibly strong. And I really wanted to say that to some extent I'm going to suggest that philosophy has to deal with this. And I think this is where I'm not going to be looking back perhaps at Socratic or some of the very older, classical, beautiful texts on philosophy and dwelling, because there's an issue of us needing to have a discussion about computation and economics. Now, one of the other things that happens in architecture is not just the building, the built form, its shape, its organic quality. It's also about the politics of it. And this is where you move into discussions about architecture and computation, which are actually more about the idea of automation. And these are discussions that, again, are very strongly in debate about labour, about the politics of whether computing, whether algorithms that are used in architecture are becoming powerful, and therefore the notion of the author, the notion of the designer is becoming less strong. There are lots of architects working with this in very interesting ways, but it's a question of ethics and of morals, and it is something that's very, very, very current at the moment. And this is a book that's an example that deals with this. Finally, I want to come to the conversation of ecology. Again, a conversation that in architecture is dealt with and has been dealt with very, very well and in interesting ways for centuries around the idea of environmental design, of producing buildings or environments that are in some ways dealing now obviously with CO2 emissions and reduction of carbon, but also the idea of well-being and the idea of contact with nature, the notion of human-nature relations. But what I want to also highlight is that there are also architects and also philosophers, particularly philosophers thinking about difference, about equality, about cultural difference, about gender, about the notion of the world being formed not just from European thought, but from thought that exists in many other nations. And these are people talking about the idea of equality and ecology through non-human relations. And this is also brings up a question about whether 17th century or 18th century, really, humanism is sufficient enough now to deal with issues of ecology. And so, for example, if you're interested in discussions of the Anthropocene, you may be aware that these sorts of conversations come up here. And the point is that computation, technology, the way in which we build and design our world is not necessarily always human-centred. We are possibly positively and sometimes quite critically and with anxiety and concern thinking about non-human relations. But I want to highlight three female thinkers who I would call philosophers, although they may not be seen as classic philosophers, because they deal with science and ecology. And those are Donna Haraway, who is a wonderful thinker from the Berkeley, who is actually an evolutionary geneticist, and she talks about companion species, the need for society to develop an ethics which is not just human-centred, but which thinks about the idea of diversity of species. Very ecological, very kind of contemporary discussions of climate science. The other person is someone called Lorraine Code, and she's a Canadian, previously a teacher, who talks about ecological thinking as a kind of notion of a new ethics and responsibility. And finally, I want to mention Isabel Stengers, who does come from a more philosophic background. And she is trained as a chemist. She's also into ethics. And she's very into the idea of relations and of processes, the idea of process, not the notion of stasis. So I'm going to close there just with three comments about thinkers who are around at the moment who, if you're interested, do this kind of work. Thanks.
Can I ask you a tough question to start with? Let's just get to the gristle. So that image of Beirut, if you know Beirut, then those computational model, the Zaha Hadid, I understood that you were issuing a critique of that kind of agentless computational model of architecture. But if you know Beirut, then most of Beirut is those shrapnel embedded buildings, right? And so if the other side of the argument is a kind of agent-led architecture, agents are not always noble architects. They shoot each other and they destroy their buildings.
No, so this is the point. The agental architecture, the notion of computation and this idea of celebrating a move away from the single author is really problematic. And one of the issues is that often architects who really enjoy this work only talk about geometry and about form, and they remove the notion of a building from its socio-political context. And I have to say, there's a very recent example of that, which was Patrick Schumacher from Zaha Hadid's office, who made a lot of statements about housing and about public and private finance. And it's a very clear example of an architect who doesn't really see there being a kind of location of computation and of a sort of a social technology into the sphere. So yes, that's why this style has the other historic qualities of Beirut.
And there's hazard involved in that too, right?
Yeah, but I think there are ways in which people who are interested in computational software will argue that there are there's a kind of way in which you can produce loss of control.
Yeah.
You can remove the notion of the author-centred production because you can use algorithms, and that the algorithm has a sense of self-corrective quality of design in it. Now, in many respects, this is a kind of poetic or a metaphorical notion of changes in authorship.
Right.
I mean, there may well be people in the audience who would want to add to this conversation, but yeah, it's a debate that gets often used very strongly by certain kinds of architectural training to propose a more socially large-scale move from the idea of the architect is just one person working in a context of a studio producing a drawing and then a building. And I mean, that's interesting because it is the issue of how architecture is located into science, technology and large-scale capital global infrastructure. So it's not, but it's just sometimes the way in which it gets concluded. There's a way in which some of those sorts of real questions of how businesses are structured get sometimes left out.
Juliet and Kristen, did you want to add to the conversation?
Well, no. Well, I was just going to say, I thought that when you mentioned Schumacher, I don't know whether this is a myth or not, that Zaha Hadid said that for her architecture, context is a blank sheet of paper, which I don't know if anyone can verify that is true, if that's a myth, but it seems to be
the worst
example of what you're talking about, where there's no kind of context what you're designing. You start from form.
Yeah. And just a question, the three thinkers that you mentioned at the end, would that be a redress to this situation?
Yeah, thinking? So yeah. My sort of closing comments, this sort of shift from computation to ecology, which there are people who work with computation and ecology who see the, you know, some interesting alignments, would be to suggest that we need possibly, or perhaps philosophy actually is one of the places where conversations about the relationship of technology, nature and human society can be looked at. And I do think there are people doing that. And I think that these are people who are sometimes called feminist philosophers, and I think that's very interesting and actually very positive, because I do think it possibly sets up the idea that difference is something that is not just a kind of category. It's actually about how society can be critical, take responsibility, and also how philosophy can be very good at those kinds of things.
Yeah.
Does anyone want to ask a question or make a comment while they're loading?
We're having our technical issues.
Yeah. Isn't it just sort of that rather like if you take computation, as long as you do it in moderation and you integrate ecology, and then don't you just get back to that point of, yeah, sure, everything in moderation, and then the sort of debate loses is sort of like bigger.
Yeah, I don't think I was saying that.
No, well then that's my misinterpretation.
Okay.
But I just wanted to know, like, if that is how it's done, isn't then it, well, maybe if I misinterpreted, maybe you can correct me.
Sorry, I was being too quick, but yeah, I think it's not just about the idea of moderation. I think that's what some architects who want to keep a notion of technology that is independent of other kinds of social forces intact, but I think it's more about changing the structure between those two, and this is where I think philosophy is very good at doing it. So I don't think it's just about contingency or about setting up ratios that don't also restructure. I think there's a conversation actually about material production and the notion of matter, which is a wonderful history in philosophy that can actually be very interesting for architecture. So that I would that would be my comment there.
Let's get Kristen.
Okay, so I'm just going to read, and the slides are going to play. So I'm actually glad that it messed up because it'll now play. And just to let you know, I'm going to be working with a kind of referencing called free indirect speech. So I won't be kind of naming the sources, but I'm mainly tracing an argument from a woman named Kathy Carruth in a book called Unclaimed Narratives, History, Trauma, and Narrative. Unclaimed history. But just to, to clear that up. An apple falls. Thwack. A man, Sir Isaac Newton, understands that all objects in the universe are falling toward one another with the same force that pulls this apple invisibly toward the ground. This is the same force that, as Newton would surmise, links the tides to the lunar cycle and keeps the planet moving on their elliptical paths around the sun, the moons around their planets, as was described but not explained by Johann Kepler. This is the same force that, following the explosion of a phenomenally hot, extraordinarily dense primordial atom, caused the gases of hydrogen and helium to condense into clouds, out of which the stars were formed, then the galaxies, then more galaxies and clusters, and onwards and outwards and ever-expanding made the universe. The same force that allows us to slip so easily into this world then presents us with continual challenges once we are in it, especially when we endeavor to become upright and later to practice architecture. The attractive force that Newton identified became the basis for a natural law, represented through a mathematical formula. This force also became a concept represented by the word gravity. As a mathematical formula describing a natural law, gravity could be applied perfectly to the world. However, as a word, gravity seemed like a magical entity, its referent an invisible, unforeseen force. How could a force make itself felt across seemingly empty space without any medium or perceivable contact? As Newton concedes, quote, some persons will probably be ready to inquire what is the hidden cause of this hidden virtue, or sorry, what is the cause of this hidden virtue of gravity, which is here attributed to the heavenly bodies. To this, the only answer is that this cause is as yet one of nature's secrets, and perhaps it will ever remain so, quote. Having been ushered into a paradigm where nature operated according to cause and effect, as a cue ball scatters its colored constellation across the billiard table, gravity remained an effect without a cause, and this inevitably prompted criticism. The philosopher Leibniz labeled Newton's conception of gravity a cult, while fellow scientist Christian Huygens deemed it absurd. Newton himself, the great physicist, alchemist, and theologian, admitted that the idea of gravity acting on objects at a distance was so great an absurdity that no man who has in philosophical matters a competent faculty of thinking could ever fall into it. So an object, an apple, falls, and a concept, gravity, arises, the concept of a force that could be witnessed but not known, an attractive force with a forceful effect on the thinking of the time. Indeed, the concept of gravity would effect a paradigmatic shift away from a universe in motion and into a world of falling. So this beginning, falling and rising toward the end of the 17th century, would mark a conceptual turn. Following this turn for a moment, we arrive
at what appears to be a slight deviation, a question. A question that has dogged philosophy for centuries. What is the relationship between the word and the world? Deceptively simple in appearance, this question extends language beyond a mere act of naming and far beyond the idea that language is simply a mimetic representation of reality. Implicit in this relationship between the word and the world is a performative act, one that organizes what it enunciates. In the 17th century, this relationship between word and world was understood analogically through its relation to analytical geometry. Just as analytical geometry, a symbolic system imbued with phenomenal reference, was used to measure the world, so language, another symbolic system also imbued with phenomenal reference, was used to describe it. Now, up until this story started, that is, up until the apple fell, the phenomenal world that analytical geometry had described so successfully as a world governed by the laws of motion. A recent account suggests, however, that once Newton posits that the motion of massive bodies separated in space could be explained by an attractive force actually pulling these bodies toward one another, in other words, once the world of simple motion turns into a world of falling, the most adequate means of describing the world becomes a mathematical formula, one without phenomenal reference. Somewhat paradoxically, so Kathy Carruth says, analytical geometry and language could no longer adequately describe the world. As a result, and as a much later philosopher will argue, philosophy after Newton becomes a confrontation with questions about how to talk about falling. More precisely, the philosophical problem of reference, which this later philosopher Paul de Man will associate specifically with the post-Newtonian era, is actually a problem of how to refer to falling. According to the pragmatist John Dewey, a problem does not exist without a solution. This is not to say that every problem finds its resolution, far from it. Rather, until one proposes a solution, there exists not a problem, but simply a situation. We can therefore assume that the question of the relationship between the word and the world does indeed present a problem for philosophy, for it is a philosopher who comes up with the solution, Immanuel Kant. Writing in his Critique of Judgment, Kant presents his solution to the problem of reference. Firstly, he distinguishes between metaphysics and transcendental philosophy. On the one hand, metaphysics is understood as an expansion of Newton's laws of motion, an empirically derived set of laws that are dependent on direct observation and knowledge of the world for their meaning. On the other hand, transcendental philosophy is construed as an entirely conceptual system, one that makes possible thinking about the empirical world in the first place. With his development of philosophy as a transcendental conceptual system, Kant thus solves the problem of reference, or more precisely, the problem of how philosophy can refer to bodies in a world of falling by freeing philosophical discourse from any need or obligation to know the world at all. Philosophy comes to know itself instead as precisely that which does not directly know or speak of worldly phenomena. This is indeed a neat solution, but one that bears a contradiction, a resistance within its very design. Paul de Man locates this resistance to the transcendental project at two significant points in Kant's writing, both of which involve a body. The first instance is when Kant illustrates his distinction between metaphysics and transcendental philosophy through recourse to how each relates to the phenomenon of bodies in motion, or more specifically, how each addresses the question of what causes a change in bodies in motion. In this instance, metaphysical law would state that changes in a body in motion must have an external cause. This is because in Newtonian times, all nonlinear motion is caused by an external force. In contrast, transcendental law would simply state that all changes in a body in motion must have some cause, thus leaving open the possibility that the change in bodies in motion is caused by something internal to the very system of thought through which these bodies are conceived. From this example, one can see how metaphysics addresses questions about the world through recourse to natural law, thereby showing its dependence upon empirical studies of the world. Transcendental philosophy, however, addresses questions about the world without recourse to natural law, thereby showing its independence from empirical study, and with this, abandoning any need to refer to the physical world in addressing questions relating to it. As this example shows, metaphysical thought differs from transcendental thought through the relationship that each has to the physical world. Crucially, It is the very fact that Kant's example shows us this difference that suggests its inherent resistance to his transcendental project. By introducing this example, Kant effectively sets up a secondary definition of transcendental philosophy, one that sits alongside his conceptual definition so that we might be able to see and grasp his understanding. The example, offered up as an object of study, thus undermines the very premise of a purely conceptual project. Another instance where a body appears in Kant's writing, further suggesting resistance at the heart of his transcendental project, is when he invokes the glider, a whole, unified, and upright body made up of a number of parts, as the figure for philosophy. This figure stands in direct contradistinction to the falling empirical body, the body to which philosophy could no longer refer, for which it had therefore relinquished responsibility. Thus, transcendental philosophy relinquishes direct reference to the empirical body in its self-definition, yet, paradoxically, it is only by reintroducing it figuratively, embodying it within language, that it is able to do so. In an interesting twist to this story, Paul de Man makes a direct comparison between the figure of the glider in Kant's philosophical writing and the figure of a puppet, or the gliderman, in a short story by Heinrich von Kleist entitled On the Marionette Theater. In this story, the principal dancer of a ballet company attends a marionette theater and during the course of the event notes the perfection of the puppet dance. As the dancer points out, this perfection is purely mechanical, since the puppeteer is able to manipulate the puppet's center of gravity by simply pulling on the strings. There is nothing of the clumsiness of the human being. Instead, the limbs are what they should be, dead, mere pendula, governed only by the law of gravity. This puppet body is Kant's philosophical body. Through this further figuration, the philosophical body as a series of articulated parts not only moves but dances, and not only dances but does so gracefully. Still, any grace attributed to the marionettes in Kleist's story lies not in the puppets themselves but in the transformations that occur between the puppeteer and the puppet. That is to say, the puppet, and by analogy Kant's philosophical project, has no motion in and of itself, being composed of lifeless mechanical limbs. Instead, all of its mobility lies in the text that spins between the puppeteer and the puppet. And it is through this text that the puppet, that philosophy, appears to be rising and falling, as if no such thing as gravity existed, as if it had achieved a kind of grace.
Question about gliders. So the parallel you were drawing between, what was it, analytical geometry and language struck me a little bit like the parallel that Peg was drawing between philosophy and architecture, except that Peg was saying the connection is building, and in your case you were saying the connection is falling, or seemed to be falling. And I wondered if there was something elegiac or something, and also obviously you cite Kathy Caruth, who writes about trauma, whether you're thinking about not about elevation and transcendence, you're thinking about the glider who is struggling to get off the ground and who must eventually come down, right?
Yep. I mean, I think I was kind of letting things kind of hang there and putting some of the buildings with that text, but in not a dissimilar way from what Peg was talking about, implicitly kind of suggesting that some kinds of architecture, maybe it's more the paper architectures, the kind of visionary architectures, the speculative architectures, which are so important for thinking about change and, you know, futurity, utopia. But to some extent, maybe working in a kind of contextless situation at times. And, you know, so for example, the Himmel bed, the cloud bed, where is that? Up there somewhere in the sky. You know, so that there's a kind of a sense that it is like the glider, like the puppet, that it is the, quote, architect that is pulling these strings, and that this text, the building, is spinning, and that there isn't anything like gravity for it to have to kind of work against. And I guess I'm kind of also, you know, playfully kind of suggesting that I suppose if architecture has anything that it's constantly resisting, it's falling. So the law of gravity is the one thing that it really can't avoid. And so you can be as speculative and as, you know,
wild in one's imaginings, but you've got to always have the engineer there. So there's something really inherently pragmatic about architecture. It's coupling this kind of visionary quality at times with this very kind of pragmatic aspect. And then I guess the other thing I was trying to slip in there were a couple of instances where, for example, like the Mies van der Rohe photo collage.
Which one was that?
The Chicago, south side of Chicago, and then there's like a plonked grid on top. This is an example of an architectural plan that is actually informed by a lot of kind of modernist paintings, grids, which is a kind of mythic configuration. It kind of plonked it right on the south side of Chicago. In doing that, in that visionary kind of moment, eradicated a number of the people or the living situations of the people living there and a whole kind of cultural context. Exposing maybe that some of those kind of instances can either be problematic in that way and we can kind of question them and critique them. And then in other instances, like there was the one with the poetic act of Open City, which is a kind of radical pedagogical experiment in Valparaiso, Chile, where a lot of the building is done on shifting sand. And here's an instance where the ground itself is actually shifting, and the architecture, you know, that's always made in this kind of ad hoc way has to constantly resist it and kind of move and change. And there's something really kind of exciting, I think, about those kind of moments where it isn't necessarily a kind of design plonked in on the ground, but it's constantly working with the permutations of the material reality that it's dealing with.
That's fascinating.
Yeah.
For later.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll save it for later. I've got a million. How does a building on shifting sand work? What are the mechanics to make it upright, to stop it from falling? Hanging, even.
Interestingly, because we went to visit Open City, and they were actually making a new building in the sand. And so as poetic and wonderful as it sounds, they actually were putting a big concrete block down in the sand. It was really quite funny. And then in the meantime, like on a hill, there are the remnants of this concrete block and a building that once was, that's now completely covered in sand because the vectors changed and suddenly, you know, the building that was there to house an exhibition was just covered over. I love the kind of material constraints and the way that, you know, it's kind of impossible at times to predict and master them.
Let's glide on to our next speaker. It's Juliet.
Thanks. Hi, everyone. I'm something of an imposter here in a sense that I'm neither an architect nor an artist, but when Shahada invited me to speak at this event, I thought that actually there's several questions within the summary of the text which really strike a chord with me, and I spend an awful lot of time thinking about. And in particular, how could a three-dimensional space represent an idea? And I work 3 days a week within a design team on a number of projects and have done for a while. And so that actually the processes by which a large-scale design, of which my work is only one small element, come into being is something I spend a lot of time thinking about. So I thought I'd just, if you'll forgive me, just using that as a case study so that I'm really clear what I'm talking about, and then talk about actually some of the current conditions that almost the language within which buildings are mediated and come into being, or these big projects, and what the implications of that might be in terms of our imagining a city of the future, because I think they're very pressing, and I think, as Peg mentioned, there's a huge amount at stake in the current way in which digital design is involved with this. So just to introduce, this is the original building that was built 200 years ago on the site in Bristol. It's one of the first generations of purpose-built prisons in the UK. So the whole aspect of the site has a close relationship with a panopticon. It's about having a central power core, if you like, which all activity in the prison, or rather lack of it, can be monitored from a central power structure. It's complete silence and complete visual control within the site. All that remains is the jail gate in the centre there, that on the way into the prison. The rest of the site's been demolished over the last 200 years. And this is the new scheme that's been designed by Alec French. It's a multi-million pound big development that includes shops, but mostly flats. It doesn't show up very well on the slide, but the jail gate is just here. so that you work your way through it and then walk down through the pedestrian scheme. And what I was interested in the site was the fact that this is, in a sense, no offence to Alec French, but it's a fairly generic, it's not a particularly radical piece of design in a broad sense, and it fits by the police's secure by design guidelines, which means that it uses passive surveillance, so lots of windows overlooking, no hidden spaces, so that when you're on the site you feel very safe because you might be being overlooked at any time. So I was interested in trying to come up with something that would fit within the scheme more broadly, but actually ended up being boiled down to just something within the jail gate, where I reused some of the details because there's some amazing historic drawings from the original scheme that still exists but are rather undervalued. They're in a crumbling condition. But there's these lovely details, and translating that to be in glass with a very thin steel frame and then opening up apertures which are bricked up in the structure so that you can see into the historic site, but that also reflect back views, so that hopefully it would have a really sensitive relationship to light conditions on the site, so that at night it would allow views in, and during the day it might be quite reflective. So the kind of getting the glass right was key. That's just a little model on the right there, so still not being built yet. So throughout that project, I was working within a tiny budget within a much bigger project, but following within this enormous juggernaut of the design team kind of client relationship, which follows the REBA scheme of works. This was updated in 2013, so architects in the audience, I'm sure you're very familiar with this in case people here are not. This is essentially the stages of work through which a large, any scale project could be applied. You could apply this same principle from a building extension to an airport. And essentially you just have this stage of works as you described there. But just to make it perhaps a little bit simpler, traditional contract, and I'm simplifying this quite a lot, but essentially you'd have an ongoing relationship with the client and the design team right through the process. So within the design team, I'm including architects, but any number of other professionals who are involved with the project. Somewhere around developed design in stage four, you'd be in contact with a builder of some kind and put the project out to tender, and get costings and so on for that. They would then get on board and they would join the process through to the end of the project. So that's fairly straightforward. A lot of, perhaps even all, or certainly the majority of contemporary schemes of a certain size are now undertaken with a different kind of contract, which is called design and build. And the way design and build works is that you don't have any problem or issue arising where there's any question about where liability lies. So when you've got these enormous investments in schemes, it's convenient for a client to know exactly where the buck stops. And the way this is done is by the client and the design team working, or the design team working for the client up until stage five. And then bundling up a package of drawings in incredible detail, down to the door handles and window apertures. If you imagine a scheme on, you know, the size of a building with 100 flats in it, the level of detail has to be incredibly precise. So that package of drawings can then be costed precisely, and then the client can decide who they want to choose to work forward. Then after that point, the building contractor becomes the client, essentially. They are running the whole scheme and they have ownership of the design. So with the project I was working on, I had this strange situation where the client told me that essentially I need to make designs for my element that could then be put out to contract within the main contract, and then that would then get built by a subcontractor. So I wouldn't know who my person is who's responsible for making my work, let alone the subcontractor of that. And because I was working with very fine, I wanted to get the reflective quality of the glass and the detailing within the steelwork. I'm not an expert in glass and steel, in the same way that an architect can't possibly be expert in all aspects of glazing, insulation, and so on. So I actually essentially didn't have a way really to continue working in this way. And if you notice that that in this previous stage of work, what historically has been the case is that you have a much more fluid continuing conversation with possible fabricators, so that becomes a really important part of your design. A really great anecdote, which I totally love, is an architect who I admire greatly called Carlo Scarpa, working in Venice in the 70s, had all of his designs were really influenced by the technology and the skills and crafts that were happening within Venice at the time. And he went to visit the Biennale sometime in the 70s with his plasterer, who he used, called De Luigi. And they went to see the Rothko show and were both so impressed by the way that he created these coloured surfaces that they decided together that that was a finish that they were going to imply to put into their building they were working on at the moment. I mean, that relationship is impossible with this sort of structure of work. So essentially, these conversations used to be, perhaps without being too romantic about it, although maybe that's appropriate for today, but anyway, they were designs mediated by conversations, by drawings, but also something to do with distance and proximity, which is changing a huge amount in the current climate, if you like. So, this is an extraordinary example of this from a completely other period in building. Perhaps you could argue this isn't architecture in the sense that we know it now, but I think it's quite instructive. This is York Minster, and this is the Mason's drawing office that you can see on the left. It's a really well-appointed room. It had its own fireplace, even a flushing toilet of sorts, which is not bad for the 1300s. So it was a, you know, special, well-respected place within the cathedral, within the Minster, sorry. And on the floor there, so it's quite a large room, a layer of plaster would be laid on which the geometry forming the windows would be inscribed. And this is a view, a kind of forensic redrawing of some of those marks etched in the floor on the right-hand side. So this gives an idea. This is the floor on the left within the scale of the whole room. And this is the whole room within the fabric of the Minster. So it still exists now. So that idea of building a civic project on this scale, but within which there's a special room that not only exists as an active drawing office while the building is in progress, but then for the centuries afterwards, so this is 600 years we're talking about, remains in place as a kind of archive. So in this photograph, again, you can see on the wall here, these are the templates hung up. These are later, mostly late in tin and zinc. They're, I think, 19th century mostly. But they would be records, and they could be used again if you needed to repair any of the stonework. You'd have this kind of thing actually built within the fabric of the building. And I was thinking, what an incredible luxury that is to have that sense of proximity to the project that you're designing. So I thought, this is kind of interesting for me to just do a quick little audit. So the project I'm working on in Bristol, this gives an idea of where the offices are of the different members of the design team. And this should come as, this is no surprise, you know, I'm not suggesting anything revolutionary or unusual about this. It's the fact that this is normal, which I think makes it remarkable. And so, of course, this is a project that has been going on over several years, and it continues to be going on. So that whole conversation of developing this enormous scheme has to be mediated, not through conversation so much, or that's sort of difficult and in a sort of multiple people involved in that. So essentially it's mediated primarily through drawing, but also through specification and through text. So I think talking of the world and the word is very much relevant. And this is not a window, which the rest of us are thinking about using window as a case study, this because I don't have an up-to-date specification drawing, but this is a detail for another project I'm working on. And this gives you an idea of how this type of line drawing at the level of actually specifying and ordering the building to take place is accompanied by this very detailed specification, so British standard, so that, you know, you can say to a tenderer, I need whatever product you choose has to meet these specifications, or putting in a manufacturer's catalogue into your designs and saying, or similar, for contractual reasons. So you're essentially becoming a kind of personal shopper as a designer for the architect, for the client, rather than designing in a way that you might historically consider design. So I was thinking again, this is one of the windows in York. So just thinking about this as a case study and reconsidering that in today's terms. So these windows are an integral part of what we consider that building and its architecture. They're structural and they're aesthetic. They're functional and decorative, practical and ornamental. So, you know, they're multiple things all at once. They combine two media, stone and leaded glass. But actually, what's interesting is to think about how those two very simple kind of different materials come together, but actually could come through quite different design routes, if you like. That actually, if you were making the tracery, the stone elements, that translates very well into contemporary digital design software. It's incredibly easy to make very elegant, symmetrical geometry. Anyone who's done kind of CAD 101, it's almost the first window like this you could make probably within 5 minutes. Making the glass, much less so. You can buy different coloured glass, but actually in terms of the painting, it doesn't lend itself to vectors, i.e., you know, kind of active line drawing within a software program. And it's much more related to taste and kind of the slippery qualities of making an artwork than the stonework is itself. So this is this is one of the templates being applied. You can imagine that coming straight out of a software program. So in a way, actually, I think what this describes is perhaps an interesting comparison between art and architecture, and to do with authorship and fabrication, because I think, as has been already raised, that idea of authorship within architecture is very kind of contested, and perhaps also what this software that's become ubiquitous leaves out. So Alberti, who's a 15th century Florentine architect and writer, he wrote about the order in which you make a painting in his book Della Pittura, because I'm being a bit taking too long to describe all this. I won't quote that, but essentially he wrote about the hierarchy in making a painting, which is first of all that you create an outline. Then you compose your outlined objects into a composition, and finally you add colour and light, so you do colouring in. So these are SketchUp views. SketchUp is a software program that's like run by Google, but it's a generic software program, and you could apply this to lots of designs. So this is, again, the same site in Bristol. So here's your circumscription, then composition in the... You arrange these objects within the scheme. You add colour and light. And actually within this, you also kind of do... any kind of materiality also counts as colouring in. So within this way of working, what's at stake here is the fact that the software lends itself to outlined elements that can be articulated and also named. So that idea of word and the word becomes really part of the design process. And actually anything else that might be more equivalent to the glass is inevitably... It doesn't facilitate that, so it gets left out. So what we've got essentially on large schemes, this is a situation which this combination of naming of parts and this kind of drawing software gives a huge amount of power to large-scale building firms because of the contractual arrangements, represses working conversations between designers and fabricators because that can't pass through the bottleneck of the design-build contract. It facilitates standardisation and use of materials finishes that fit within British standard classifications. And it also privileges drawing in terms of outline rather than colour, texture, materiality, anything experiential, any other aspects of the architectural, the built environment that we might actually really want to treasure. So, I mean, this is slightly facetious. Oh, and there we go. That's what actually is going on underneath this software. So that's essentially the kind of architecture of contemporary architecture in the generic form. So this is slightly contentious for me to put this in a way, but Alberti's description of his order of circumscription, then composition, then colour and light is very Florentine for that period. Michelangelo on the left fits that perfectly. So you can see the drawing is the thing that's holding that picture together. The colouring in is secondary. Michelangelo said that Titian was a crap artist because he couldn't draw. I think, you know, obviously art history has maybe got a different view, but I think that kind of different painting in which the colour and the paint and the light come first maybe form a really interesting analogy for another kind of process through which we can make buildings that is much more experiential and subtle and value materiality in a different way. So finally, sorry, I'm running over. I just thought these are four precedents, which are ongoing projects now, which might give a clue or an example of how to maybe resist the generic and what that might offer. So first of all, elementals architecture, super interesting, top left, where they break down a building project into the bits that only an architect, a specialist, can do, and just put that in first. So essentially they're making the shell, and then people can add their own, build in the parts later when they can afford it. So the balconies and other parts are filled in later by people once they move in. So it's allowing room within a building contract for people once for the inhabitants. Assemble, who are very well known for winning the Turner Prize a couple of years ago, they've just moved to the Sugar House Studios in Bermondsey. And their model for a studio practice is to include workshops for metal workers, for ceramicists, for carpenters, so that bumping up of people working in different materials becomes part of a working conversation for them. Muff Architecture Art, who I worked for a while, it's a project in Barking where they essentially levered a level of care and detail into a project by setting this up as a Section 106 agreement, by turning that architecture into an art project. So by reclassifying it, they could add richness to the scheme. And finally, a lot of technology, such as this prototype, which uses the linear path of 3D printing to imagine a kind of form and style, perhaps, which is not so orientated around circumscription and outline. So I think that question of like questioning the generic standard is a really important thing within the moment we're in now. Sorry for running
Thank
over.
You. Thank you. Can I be a bit naughty and ask you a slightly, because it's so lovely listening to your practice. So, so your argument is about resisting the outsourcing of work, the contractors and the fabrication that goes elsewhere, and reinstating the place of the drawing. But it seems to me, as a prize-winning drawer, that would be a case, an argument that you would, of course, make. And I wondered if you've had moments in your own drawing life where... And you say you sort of concede that it's a slightly romantic notion about, you know, having the room in which the architect lives and in the building, but in reinstating the place of the drawer and having them connected to the site they're working in, have you had moments also when the realisation of the drawing has been a disappointment or hasn't quite realised the dream of the drawing?
Yes. I mean, I think probably that wouldn't be unique to my experience. I'm sure the idea of something can have a like glittering mystery about it that the reality never does. And actually the amount of architectural drawings which have, you know, hot air balloons and sunsets and all of that way of perhaps cynically selling a scene but also imagining it, which is not the same as the kind of grey midday London midwinter view. But so yes, I think that is, but actually I'm not saying that this is about resisting the drawing. What I'm arguing is that the kind of drawing technology that is ubiquitous now facilitates a particular kind of drawing. And so in the same way that if you're drawing with a 2H pencil, you're going to go for probably describing outline. And if you wanted to do something incredibly rich and tonal, it's not going to lend itself to that. If you were, say, working with charcoal, you're probably going to start drawing with shadows and tone because charcoal lends itself to that. Yeah. So if we're working with software like this, why are we taking it that it's just, we're sort of capitulating in the idea of vector outline is the drawing language. Even if it's not clear in the kind of visualizations that are presented to the public, it's the kind of, it's the skeleton which within which all generic contemporary architectural schemes are practiced. And therefore, it has there's a huge amount at stake in terms of the shaping of our cities, because we're having projects which are formed from one specific drawing language.
This is an important conversation. We should open it out to the floor and we'll get our speakers to respond too. So are there questions? Let's get these two for the time being. Oh, and then the gentleman just behind the lady there. So the gentleman in the middle there with the hoodie. Yeah,
great, thank you. For Peg, I wanted to ask, if you sort of reference sort of Spinoza and say that you're trying to take these abstract things and make them into an analytic system by using, say, sort of axioms in the way that you would in geometry, surely then, and you talk about these ratios that exist in housing, and surely algorithms seem sort of like the natural conclusion to go towards when you're talking about these types of things, and it's the role of the architect to perhaps sort of consume the people who are making these algorithms and teach them a sort of creative way, because if you personally, I've looked at sort of fractal art, and it seems that you can create sort of quite beautiful things, and there is a sort of creativity to using algorithms and this type of thing. But I was just wondering if you have any, like at the Bartlett, for example, do you teach like fractal art or sort of algorithmic sort of art or visual programming in any way, or if is that a thing? I don't know.
Okay.
The lady at the front with the rose.
Hello, I've got a question for Peg as well. My background is in healthcare initially, and what I did in the past mostly was dealing with people who have become ill because of their environment, but this is not made explicit professionally. So what I'm doing now is I'm back in academia, and I'm looking at research into how the urban environment leads to worsening of certain health conditions. And I was particularly interested in your documentary about Equal by Design and how that relates it to well-being. Now, I've had a look at certain instruments to measure well-being now, research instruments, and I do wonder what sort of ways you use to measure well-being, and how do you define well-being?
Okay, and then the gentleman behind you.
Thank you. Hello. I've come here all the way from Kent because I was excited by the questions which were raised in here. Sadly, they haven't been answered directly.
Why don't you ask them? Which particular question?
The questions in your program in here.
Can you pick a particular question and we'll try and answer it? We aim to please.
As, you know, as to terms, you know, what is a philosophical idea in terms of a space of a building? You know, how does a building actually conform to the environment? We talked about architects most of the time, but I would like to say I would pay tribute to master builders from the third world, particularly in Arab Islamic architecture, where they have achieved thermal comfort conditions within severe climatic conditions, 50 degrees Celsius in the shade, and 15% relative humidity. They achieved thermal comfort conditions within the comfort zone without any mechanical or electrical devices whatsoever. And I did my PhD on that at the Bartlett, you know, some years ago. And it's interesting that Harvard University and MIT, when I was visiting fellow there, they actually introduced a program for the students to study indigenous architecture in various parts of the world.
Okay, so that's
and I think we should pay tribute to the master builders, because effectively they are really architects, although they haven't been to a school of architecture per se. And I am proud to say my family produced 12 master builders over three generations.
So that's a question about indigenous building. I think that would be really interesting to answer. I hope you've got the resources. Let's go with the first question, which was about seeding to algorithms, Peg.
Okay, so thanks very much for that. It's a great question, because you're linking obviously the idea of ratio and geometry as a kind of drawing technology with the way in which you could really think about changing design. So the project that I talked about, the Equal by Design project, actually looks at ratio not in terms of a software or a conversation of how drawing computationally deals with ratios. And just for everyone here, just because it links really to Juliet's point, one of these terms that gets used at the moment is called parametricism. And this is the idea of computational software programs, not actually so much Vectorworks, but Rhino and Grasshopper. They're these, actually, interestingly, there are these software programs that have lovely names, animal names. And I think there's a project there really actually about this use of the notion of animals and evolution and this idea of computation having the potential to change. The idea is transformation. You don't end up with blueprints that get repeated in without transformation. So this is the principle behind it. But actually, just to answer your question about ratio and the idea of how we used it in that project, actually, we were looking at really social empirical evidence about the issues of financing, of housing, of the design of housing that's not so much about the formal material aesthetic building, although I have been looking, and there's very interesting discussions about 1970s social housing, for example, done by the Camden and the London Council, really brilliant projects where you get beautiful discussions about ratio. But we were looking really much more in social conversations about the issues today, about the lack of equality of housing. So this is about social economics, about issues of affordability, issues of mortgage, issues of economics. The one point where it did come into contact with a drawing or a kind of a geometric ratio was actually also the work that I was doing on the Parker Morris space standards, which is this really important part of the welfare sort of transformation of housing, which was looking at the idea that there are known and there are important standards of space that produce well-being. And if you go below these, you are actually very much producing a cognitive, a biological, you produce a real change physiologically. And this slightly links to your question. So I wasn't using the argument of ratio into a kind of computational aesthetic, personally. But there are people who do that. Shall I go to the second question?
I think Kristen and Juliet have something to say about well-being and architecture.
I suppose there's a question I'd make about the well-being as well. Can I just say that before, just to link, because it links to the second question. So your question about well-being. Our definitions of well-being were obviously from Spinoza. We were making the case that he was a philosopher of well-being. But we were also actually then talking to Shelter and to the Equality Trust, and also looking at notions of well-being that come very much from social science, from empirical studies of, for example, overcrowding, empirical studies of where issues of asthma, of mental health issues are coming through. So we weren't necessarily generating our own data on well-being. We very intentionally also wanted our project not just to be academics, because, I mean, you probably know that these charities produce amazing research. They are really, really strong researchers, particularly people involved in housing welfare, so Roundtree, etc. So that was where we decided we would take the content very intentionally, as a kind of tribute, really, to that kind of expertise.
Well, about well-being, I think in a broader sense as well, there's really interesting projects. In fact, that one of the last ones, which was the Barking example, that I think Muff did an amazing job with that. And their methodology for working is to start by finding out what's already there at a site. I think that idea of a context being, for an architect, a blank sheet of paper is something that I see a lot of students working at the AA particularly. And that the pleasure and enjoyment of using algorithms and generating incredible complex forms, and actually almost being a bit of a disappointment to think of actually making this thing physical, because it's inherently completely immaterial, and you can completely fall in love with these programs. And I don't think it's an accident that actually a lot of architecture graduates end up working for animation studios. So actually that idea, of course, you can use fractals to design with, but actually it's like, well, why can you argue that this nice looking shape should be scaled up by a factor of 1,000 and then built in the city? Why does that necessarily make it a good social space to share? So I'm not saying it necessarily isn't, but definitely there are lots of people in enjoying that process, and that part is part of design. But I also think contractually there's another aspect to that, which is actually who's working on these projects and under what. How can these enormous great investments in the city facilitate other kinds of conversation? And I think what's interesting in the example from Chile is how completely integrated into that project is an idea of who's going to inhabit those buildings at the end. And actually that's really lacking in a lot of the way contemporary building projects are conceived as investment vehicles, so that you'd flog luxury flats. I mean, all the building sites you walk past in central London, well, maybe that's not surprising for central London, but even at, you know, they tend to foreground the word luxury as if that's, you know, what the whole city needs primarily. So I think one thing, sorry, that Muff did, to go back to that, sorry, is that the folly was conceived as an artwork, but one of the reasons for that was a way of getting through a contractual situation where the reason they wanted to use brick is, in their initial site research, they found that there's a bricklaying college round the corner, And by conceiving that project in brick and working with the bricklaying college, they actually came up with a design more or less collaboratively and could then give the students an apprenticeship opportunity right on their doorstep. Mm-hmm. So people are engaged with the town square in that capacity. Now, I think that that does not fit very... It does not fit within design and build to work like that at all. But so they, by conceiving it, so artwork becomes like a kind of strategy for a way of being able to use a different kind of contract.
Yeah. Kristen, did you want to come in?
Maybe I'll come in a little tangentially and maybe try to bring in some of the third question, but I'm not sure if I can exactly. I might not have the references to do it. But I feel like there's something happening across the three presentations and in answering the questions about form. And we were talking about the ways that form is being generated, if it's computationally or with parametrics. I don't know those either. But speaking personally, one of the things that I'm really interested in at the moment is looking at different communities that are establishing forms of life that are informed by the social, political, historical context in which they're situated. And I feel like there's something around the situatedness of a number of these different practices that's coming in, so that it's not a form that is a preconceived form that's kind of plonked on. It's something that is kind of emerging in response, which may link a little bit to Peg's ecological move at the end, with the idea of maybe a more cybernetic notion of feedback with an environment, and that design can kind of emerge from that feedback. And the way I'm kind of linking it with the discussion of the master builders, again, I don't have the references, but what it sounded like is that they're responding to kind of climactic conditions, and social, yeah. And so maybe some of the mastery of that is the responsiveness to context in that particular kind of architectural situation. And I'm not sure if I could link it back into the overview of today's panel and the wording in there, but I think it was around how architecture is in our actual architectures are embodying philosophical ideas, and I wonder if the example that you're bringing up there of these master builders is in some sense a bit of a response to some of the things that we're saying about a critique of a certain sort of transcendental notion of a philosophy or an architecture, and moving more into a kind of environmentally aware, engaged, social, materially specific practice. So
let's get another set of questions.
Thank you. My background isn't in philosophy or architecture at all, so excuse me if the question's a little obtuse, but it's more so in reference to Kristen. And I may have misinterpreted it, but it seemed as if there was a suggestion that architecture, in a sense, is missing a form of resistance, which would be gravity in the case of Newton's theory. So that the main form of resistance is against falling down, in a sense. But I was thinking, architecture, of course, it elicits a kind of emotional response on part of the viewer, not necessarily universally, but I feel comfortable in saying that. But I've also noticed that in terms of social unrest, historically and contemporarily, there seems to be a revert to destroying buildings, basically. So I just wanted to know if there was a sort of debate or conversation within architectural philosophy that has tried to resist the inclination to destroying buildings in that sense.
And then the gentleman here can get the mic down.
Thank you very much. My question is a mixture of perhaps philosophical and political, and that's I'd be interested in what you all think about who architects organise space. Do they own it? Who owns the space? There are various questions, public buildings, public space. who's allowed to have private space within it. So thinking of open plan offices, which can be quite brutal in some ways, and which deny privacy. And also in terms of some of the iconic buildings, nevertheless, they may be part of a shared urban landscape. And you know, somebody, in organizing their bit of space or their client's bit of space that they own, can be destroying a view, can be destroying a sense of cohesion.
Can we get a concise third question?
Thank you. Previous talk about spreading prosperity at LSE from the Deputy Prime Minister of Singapore, we were talking about having, they thought, achieved it around building neighbourhoods rather than building buildings, where they built in that the most valuable houses they built were never more than 100 metres from the least valuable, and the least valuable were never more than 150 metres from the most expensive private houses. They made sure that everybody used the same MTR, they had the same shops, the same shared space. That to me seemed, although it wasn't on a computer, an algorithm. Why do you think that algorithmic architecture can't start to include some of those social factors, because they seem to be being practiced there?
Can we get a kinder algorithm? Yeah. Okay. So the first one was who, emotional unrest and destroying buildings, who owns a space, and then kinder algorithms.
If it's okay, I'll just take the first question. And I think you started off with the word resistance, and you were asking about, I can't remember actually everything, but what popped into my head, I just read this, I think that's why it popped into my head, Judith Butler, she's recently published an edited collection of essays, and it's about vulnerability and resistance. And one of the things she's talking about is the way that vulnerability can be a kind of resistance, or it doesn't necessarily mean that one is weak and one has to be taken care of by a paternalistic state, for example. And as she's kind of talking about this, she's talking about the erosion of infrastructure. And so, like, vulnerable bodies are exposed to precarity, so not stable jobs or housing, not good housing. And so these kind of infrastructural supports that are kind of, just kind of moving away, exposes the vulnerable body, which can then position oneself publicly in the street to resist. But she describes at one moment about the question is about the architecture of the street, who owns the street, that kind of thing. So can we assemble in these kind of public situations? I'm kind of not very well glossing an essay, but it, I think, relates a little bit with the destruction of building, the vulnerable building, and it kind of came up in Peg's slide, you know, that there is a destruction of the infrastructure and of the architectures in war-torn areas, for example, or with vandalism and these kind of things. And maybe we can begin to look at that as something that we may need to protect, and also something that is resisting whatever forces that might be impacting on it. I don't know if that answers, but...
Okay, I'm wondering if I can kind of catch all three, because they are quite related. I mean, I think what's really interesting is that, in a way, all three of you are referring also to the importance of land and land value and ownership. I mean, it is this issue of ownership and therefore the decision or responsibility of what then can happen. And so your question about buildings being destroyed, I think the thing that came to mind there specifically was around the discussion at the moment about the demolition of large local authority housing. Particularly, there's the Robin Hood Gardens. This is a very sort of UK-based response, if you like. Robin Hood Gardens, and also now, I mean, particularly around the Haygate, and large projects for social housing, of affordable housing, that are being demolished in order to allow developers to come in and produce density, and the issue being that then the socially affordable housing is gone. So the Haygate has gone from over 1,000 affordable or socially sort of economically available housing to I think under 100 or 79. So there's a way in which your question and this idea of precariousness and vulnerability is very much linked to these discussions of housing inequality and well-being in a sort of UK base. But it's very much also because these issues of demolishing housing where people have invested communities, histories, oral qualities. I mean, you know, hugely sort of ephemeral but very, very powerful narratives. This is a conversation that's very strong. So there are colleagues I could refer you to. I mean, if you wanted to follow up on it, it's a big debate. But it does link actually with the two other questions about notions of public and private ownership and the notion of how design and development is very determined by certain algorithms which are about cost and value and the issue of whether they're kind algorithms. I think your notion of an algorithm that actually is about a design principle on a not in the screen but actually as a kind of set of ratios or variables that big developers use does play out also in terms of these issues of public and private space and who owns or who can occupy. So this links also to questions about protest and resistance like the Occupy movement, to questions of precarious living, issues around, you know, migrants and those who do not have the legitimate name or political position to be in place. So I'm talking on a sort of spectrum. I know I'm moving across areas, but it does also come into play with the workplace, the notion of the office, and the notion of how you may have comfortable inhabitation with your peers, and the notion of private space within the work field as well. But the other one I just wanted to comment on again, because it's a very well written, there's a lot of debate about it, which you may have already seen, which is around the private ownership of public space and the management and the care of public space. So, for example, the King's Cross Quarter is a really strong example of that. Lots of very different debates about whether private business actually is a very good contribution to that. And one of the sort of an example that some people are saying is we need to actually have private developer ownership of public space and these as part of these algorithms of neighbourhood building that now, despite many people feeling very sympathetic to the welfare state, that kind of principle of economic organisation of land ownership, private and public space is not achievable. I'm not going to suggest an answer here, but I mean that those debates are very strong. They are taking us away from just technology as an independent way of finishing or sorting out questions of design.
I think that I'm not, again, at risk of sounding like, you know, all things in moderation. I think architecture practices are having to do so many different things at once, and the idea of, you know, being able to champion or balance all these different ways of making work is very difficult. And I think the idea of having something, using algorithms or technology to describe the neighbourhoods that you're suggesting, I mean, I can see how that could work, but I also can see how that focusing on a computer solving actually what might be relatively straightforward questions. I mean, if this is to do with, say, numbers of people or households of certain economic, you know, value relative to, say, a bus stop or something, that doesn't need an enormous amount of computation behind it, and yet you could fall in love with that whole process and imply everything goes through a computer. And in fact, we've got another reason, I think, socially at the moment to really resist the level at which this complexity has a relationship with the planning process and public accountability. So that goes into the question about who owns our space, because it's quite straightforward to talk about land ownership, but space ownership, particularly within the city, is much more complex. And again, that has a relationship with technology. On one level, there's an appalling, talking about Haygate, example recently of a planning decision of, I think, a block of social housing, I can't remember the name of it, that was destroyed, and the developer put in, you know, argued that they couldn't afford to do what they were requested to do under planning, and the planning went through, and when it went to judicial review, it came out that Hackney Council didn't have the software to open the document to actually give it any sort of interrogation. And so actually there's a way in which this software, which is really easy to think makes everything simpler, actually completely obfuscates the process and to do with public openness and accountability that I think we need to be applying with the level of urgency that Peg describes. And also, I think in terms of destroying buildings, if I've understood your question, or at least maybe a kind of version of your... Maybe this doesn't come close to what you're asking, but something that chimed with me is a really lovely project by an architect's practice called Lacatin and Vassal in Paris, where one of the issues about destroying buildings, particularly if they're already occupied, to be replaced, like Haygate was, is the fact that you're moving out a whole neighbourhood of people and making promises, which actually there's a terrible recent past of people not being able to move back in. And they came up with a scheme which they costed, where an entire tower block was improved by... on lots of different levels to do with heat, thermal performance, space standards and everything, by adding a level around the existing building, and it becomes a gorgeous thing too. But the way that the architects designed that was so that no resident had to leave their home at all. So all the building happened as a kind of second skin around the existing building. So as a model for social housing, it seems interesting to me that how rarely I've heard that mentioned. It seems like a really, really great example of an ambition, which I think that tabula rasa approach, which again the computer leads us, prefers, thank you, yeah, the computer prefers. It's like to try and sort of balance that convenience, because it's very, very seductive, the convenience of it.
It's nice to end on a good news story, right? So go home, smash your computers, get your spades, start digging sandcastles. Can I ask you to join me in thanking our speakers? Wonderful questions. We'll see you at the next forum event.